session on presbyopia. We come to the next session, which is related to dry eye, another condition which is very prevalent, and it starts becoming important in the same relevant age group. So in this session, I'd like to invite my co-chairperson, Dr. Arup Bhaumik, on stage. And Dr. Rohit Shetty has an instruction course simultaneously running in another session, so he will be joining soon. Dr. Rishi Swaroop is one of the co-speakers, and he will be arriving shortly. So we will start with Dr. Arup Bhaumik. We are going to cover dry eye, looking at the concept from the perspective of the dark side of the moon. So the moon revolves around the earth revolves around the sun. But the moon always has one particular face which is visible to us on earth. And the dark side of the moon is an expression talking about the other surface of the moon which is not visible to us. So in a way, it indicates the hidden truth, something which is there in front of us all the time, but is hidden. So dry eye is a condition that has a very similar kind of a perspective for ophthalmologists and patients. And we have a galaxy of wonderful faculty who are going to share their knowledge and experience. So I'd like to invite on stage Dr. Arup Bhaumik, Dr. Pooja Khammar, Dr. Sharon D'Souza, Dr. Shruti Kochar, and Dr. Karishma Wada, please. Wadia. Yes, please come and join on stage. Thank you. So therefore, with the release of the new DUES 2 publication, we are going to have an overview of what's new. For that, we are going to have Dr. Rishi Swaroop give us an overview. As he is busy in another session, Dr. Arup Bhaumik will go over the DUES 2 applications in Indian practice.
Good morning. So in the onset, I thanks Microvision for this wonderful session. This is a topic of the day, DUES 2's application in our practice, and what are the news in new thing in the DUES 2. So,
Dr. Arup, one second. Dr. Rishi is here. So,
Rishi? Yes. Rishi,
so
can present.
We will have Arup carry on, and then Dr. Rishi will follow.
Okay.
So, you don't describe what Rishi is going to do. You just cover the Indian application.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
There is a lot of dark side regarding the dry eye. There's still many of us. The dark sides are still, we are not practicing even DUES 1, the previous one. And we have a lot of factor, unchangeable factor in our environmental effect, in our society, in our cities. And the good part and the brighter side is the DUES 2 is coming in much brighter side, presenting new perspective of this disease. And I must congratulate brighter side is Indian pharmacological companies coming with a very good drug with very good molecules to treat our dry eye patients. I have no financial interest. I just Rishi will cover the whole what are the news in due to. I just in short in my presentation like with the overview of this what is Tear Film Society, Ocular Survey Society from 123 countries, more than 150 experts, and from our country, Dr. Virendra Sangam was there. They published that's DUES 2 in 2017. There's a lot of new thing. The history of this, in first 1992, the first international conference regarding the lacrimal glands, and 1995, there is a National Eye Institute workshop report in 1995, and before that there is no so such conference or regarding the dry eye. In 2007, there is a TOFS first published DUES 1, and that is DUES, and now 2017 that is a DUES 2 reported, which upgrade the reduce one, the highlights are the previous one is a six main attention is a six factor, and now it is a 10. There's a main important in my presentation. I will highlight the pain and sensation that is included in this deuce 2. And this is a definition of change of definition. They increase the dry eye is a multifactorial disease of ocular surface characterized by a loss of hemostasis of tear film and accompanied by ocular symptom in which tear film instability and hyperosmolarity, ocular surface inflammation, damage and neurosensory abnormality plays a etiological role. This is a previous one, division of the dry eye, but that now there's a deuce to come with a very good classification regarding the symptoms, how patient present, symptomatic, asymptomatic, with sign, without sign, and it makes very clear demarcation in our practice. We can practice according to this chart or this flow chart. In the first one, in deuce 2, there is a most consistent factor was older age, female sex, postmenopausal estrogen therapy, and suggestive was Asian race. But you can see that in new formula, deuce 2, there's a female sex, the most consistent is sex, Asian race, and the environment factor is a pollution or low humidity, which actually we are in Indian are suffering from this. And this is the classification of iatrogenic dead. And there is a randomized study in our hospital. We follow almost 6,000 cataract patients randomly after stopping of all drug. We examine them in the six month after post-op, almost 70% of the patient having some kind of dry eye symptom. So there is a high increase of dry eye patient in our practice every day. Now come to the epidemiology. This is my talk. This is a prevalence of dry eye in that is a published in deuce 2. With or without symptoms, this is 5 to different literature from 5 to 50%. And prevalence is higher, more variable when based on signs alone, and reaching almost 75%. And definitely women are higher than men. Increased with age, the dry eye increases more. And risk factor categorically increase, Asian ethnicity is mostly consistent risk factor. So we are already, as per ethnicity, we are more risk to develop dry eye. In India, so far these type of publication was available. All the publication from the India is prevalence of dry eye is 28 to 56%. And mind it, that the last publication was 2012, I think, and before that it is 2008. Population-based study in dry eye disease. So it is almost one decade back. So with the coming decade, what is the important of India and dry eye disease? We have a race as Asian, we have a high risk of developing dry eye, where environment factor is immensely deteriorating every day. So it is a very big factor in our community and our eye health. The age expectancy of Indian race is increasing, and there is a rapid urbanization of computer use, and definitely there is a malnutrition, vitamin A deficiency and diabetes. These are the not consistent, most consistent, but there is a very important factor for developing dry eye. Pollution is the main important factor in all the metro cities, even in the second tier cities, where patient more and more having the dry eye. Even children is school going children's coming with the burning sensation in our clinic and presenting with the dry eye symptom and sometimes with the sign also. The pollution is the main important hazard in our life. So This I already told that almost 64 to 75% patient having the dry eye after cataract surgery. So prevention, I don't know how we can prevent our pollution, how we can improve our environment. So it's a huge burden for all Indian, all our responsibility also to treat this patient. And for the prevention, we can't do anything. The government has to take a important role for this. The now last slide, I just want to finish this. The cost of treatment, when we're talking about the Indian scenario, this is a very important factor. If it's a minimum cost of dry eye treatment, if you use one drug, it is 250 to 700 rupees, and two drug, it is 500 to 1200. This is a minimum cost. I hope the Indian company will come with this a good quality of medicine to treat our vast population of dry eye patient. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhaumik, for giving a very wonderful overview about the relevance of DEWS2 to the Indian application. I'd like you to join on the dais as co-chairman of the session. One thing I'd like the audience to keep in mind, and he did raise a very important point, is the cost. And often we may be very careless, particularly if we are having the patient seeing multiple people, that we just, you know, carelessly just change the medication when they may still have some drops left of the older medication. And we need to be conscious about that, because the patient hangs on to every word that the doctor says. And you've written a new medicine, they may be too much in a rush to ask you that, do I throw the old one? And we need to be very practical about this. And the other thing is, of course, to have more affordable medications. And we hope that in this session we'll be able to give you some rationale in your prescribing patterns without any financial interest. It's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Rishi Swaroop, who's going to tell us about what's new in DEWS2.
Actually, it's impossible to finish this talk in 8 minutes, so I'm just going to run and just give some highlights. There's no financial interest, obviously. So this is how the DEWS2 has come about. It was first started in 2004. That was the first workshop. 2007 it got published, and after 10 years, 2017 is the next set of published reports. And we are proud that Dr. Sangwan, one of our leading cornea specialists, is part of that group. So they have multiple, it was a 2-year effort, started in 2015 and culminated in 2017. And they had 12 subcommittees and 150 experts from 23 countries who tried to kind of define several aspects of dry eye. And collectively this group is called the Tearfilm Ocular Surface Society. The objectives of the DEWS2 was to update the definition, the classification, and the diagnosis of dry eye, critically assess the etiology, mechanism, distribution, and impact of dry eye disease, and assess its management and therapy. So the earlier definition stated that dry eye is a multifactorial disease of tears and ocular surface that results in symptoms of discomfort, visual disturbance, and tear film instability with potential damage to the ocular surface. It is accompanied by increased osmolarity of tear film and inflammation of ocular surface. The new definition in DEWS2 is similar but some changes. Dry eye is a multifactorial disease of ocular surface characterized by loss of homeostasis of tear film and accompanied by ocular symptoms in which tear film instability and hyperosmolarity, ocular surface inflammation and damage, and neurosensory abnormalities play etiological roles. So why was it updated, this definition? Because it's not one thing. We know dry eye is multifactorial, and it includes both symptoms and signs. It is generally understood to be a disorder of structure or function or a condition of illness that results in specific signs or symptoms. The ocular adnexa also play a very important role, not just the tear film. The loss of homeostasis of the tear film is one of the key things that happens, and symptoms are a very important part of the definition, because often we don't see any signs, and it's important to identify the etiological roles as well in the definition. So it addresses the misperception of mutual exclusivity of aqueous and evaporative dry eye. We know that many of the aqueous deficient dry eye have evaporative dry eye as well, and vice versa. And it also accommodates patients with a conflict between signs and symptoms. So if you have a presenting patient, you try to make a used to diagnosis of dry eye, and then you see if he's asymptomatic and or symptomatic, and then you follow this kind of an algorithm to fit him into one of the spectrum of dry eye, which starts from aqueous deficient to mixed to evaporative dry eye, and then we kind of try to deal with the various management options. So central to both aqueous and lipid deficiency is the tear hyperosmolarity, and that's one of the core mechanisms in the pathophysiology of dry eye, which was also identified in the first DEWS, and we had a similar kind of a diagram in that with just a few minor changes. The structure of the tear film was defined by the tear film subcommittee, and it was defined as a lipid layer covering and integrated with a complex mixture of aqueous, mucins, and proteins, all of which work together to maintain tear film and ocular surface homeostasis. The evaporative dry eye was MGD-related evaporative dry eye, which was essentially lipid deficiency resulting in increased evaporation of tears and tear hyperosmolarity. Ocular surface related evaporative dry eye, tear film instability because of ocular surface conditions such as listed here, resulting in hyperosmolarity and widespread tear film breakup and damage. So how am I doing on time? Okay, I think I should quickly run through these. So the risk factors for dry eye disease were defined as the ones which are consistent, probable, and inconclusive. So the consistent ones were age, sex, race, MGD, connective tissue disease, Sjogren's, androgen deficiency, computer use, contact lens use, medication use, and estrogen replacement. The with or without symptoms, the prevalence ranged from 5 to 50%. And prevalence was higher or more variable when based on signs alone, reaching up to 75% in some population. It's more in women and increases with age. Asian ethnicity is a consistent risk factor. It has a significant impact on individuals as it affects vision, quality of life, and work productivity, and thereby produces an economic burden on the society. So the diagnostic methodology suggested was first a questionnaire to for assessment of symptoms, then functional tests for determination of functional visual acuity and aberrations, and then to assess the tear film stability and diagnosis of abnormality of the tear film, and then tests to assess the tear volume and tear film composition and the damage to the ocular surface. And based on this kind of a staged diagnosis, we also they also proposed a staged management algorithm for the spectrum from evaporative to aqueous deficient dry eye as follows. You can all read the dry eye workshop report for this because I am very short on time. So so basically the dry eye questionnaire score of 5 or 6 or OSDI score of 13 was considered as a positive test and indicated that the patient had dry eye. The importance of validated symptom questionnaire was that unless you ask patient, they may not elicit the symptoms. Severity of symptoms during screening may indicate need for additional testing, monitoring progression of conditions and response to treatment. Symptoms should be measured similar to measuring signs, and it enhances the standardization for further studies. So we know all these studies. So tear film breakup time of less than 10 seconds was considered important. Osmolarity cutoff value, normal was less than 300 milliosmoles per liter, mild to moderate more than 308, and severe more than 316. Interocular difference of more than 8 milliosmoles is also suggestive of dry eye disease, and difference increases with disease severity. Ocular surface staining, again positive scores, conjunctival spots more than 9, corneal spots more than 5. It's important to evert the eyelids and look for lid wiper epithelopathy, and this concept of lid parallel conjunctival folds, which is something similar to conjunctival ocellosis. You see these kind of folds in the bulbar conjunctiva near the lids. Tear film volume could be measured by meniscometry or by doing a tear meniscus height measurement on the slit lamp. For Schirmer's test, diagnostic cutoff values vary from 5 millimeters for 5 minutes or 10 millimeters for 5 minutes. The meibomian gland assessment, normal individuals, meibom is clear and expressed with gentle pressure. Individuals with NGD, meibom is cloudy, opaque, and difficult to express. I think I'm very short on time. So I think I'll stop here, and probably management aspect, you can read the due to report in the interest of time. Thank you.
Dr. Rishi, please join us in the dais. You have another talk. Okay. So it's very difficult to cover the what is news induced to. It is basically available in the website. You can download all that. The next speaker is building a bespoke rubricant, Dr. Pooja Khama.
So, good morning all. I am going to speak about why do we need a bespoke lubricant and how can we design one. As Dr. Bhaumik sir rightly mentioned, that cost is one of the most important factor in management of dry eye. So if we have a bespoke lubricant which can help our patients, it will be very good in the Indian scenario. A lot has been discussed about DEWS 2, so I'm not going to go in depth, but every year the classification and the definitions of dry eye are changing. But we are here giving the same treatment to all our patients. So the question is, every year the definitions are adding, but do we have treatment for each of the different pathways, and do we understand each pathway of the dry eye? So to find answers, my first part of the talk is going to be, why do we need a bespoke lubricant? Right now we have two options of lubricating drops. Either they are normal lubricating drops, which are CMC, HPMC or hyaluronic acid, which helps us in replenishing the tear film dysfunction and alleviate the symptoms of dry eye disease. Or we have smart lubricants, which are like cyclosporin, Zidra, tacrolimus and rebamipide, which blocks or modulates the trigger factors, which in turn drives the tear film dysfunction. So what if we can have a next generation lubricant which can act both to block or modulate the trigger factor and replenish the tear film dysfunction? Right now, the smart lubricants what we have is Restasis, Zidra, Tacrolimus, which acts on specific pathway of dry eye. It's not a global one. Either it acts, cyclosporin, for example, acts on the ICAM-1 pathway, which reduces the inflammation. Zidra acts on blocking it, and Tacrolimus acts on something else. So what if we have something which blocks everything and helps us alleviate the dry eye symptoms? So the current drawback is there are many available therapeutics such as lubricating and anti-inflammatory drugs to alleviate symptoms and reduce dry eye signs and symptoms, but the underlying cause of the disease still remains unattended. And thus there is a need for effective therapeutic agents that target the causative mechanism of the disease. So how do we design a bespoke lubricant? 2 years back, Professor Dr. Yoshinori Oshumi won a Nobel Prize in autophagy in the field of medicine. So we got inspired by him, and we wanted to see the role of autophagy in dry eye and keratoconus. This was what we published last year, indicating that oxidative stress can lead to deregulated autophagy in keratoconus patients, and we also are finding a role in dry eye patients. So to understand autophagy, first we need to understand the housekeeping mechanism of the body. If there is the housekeeping mechanism of the house is messed up, it leads to a dirty and a smelly environment. Similarly, billions and trillions of cells keep dying in our body. If they don't get degraded or die according to the need, it leads to a diseased condition. So who does this autophagy? It is a process used by eukaryotic cells to recycle old or damaged cellular components in response to cellular stress and damage. So autophagy is basically, there is a formation of autophagosome which surrounds the degraded cells. It further merges with the autolysosome, and it cleanses the degraded and the died cells out of the body. But if there is any defect in the phenomena, it leads to a defective and a diseased condition. So to format any drug or to bring any drug into clinical practice and patient use, this is the format which we need to use. We have to have a concept idea, then we need to create an experimental model. We need to prove our concept, and then we need to study it in a disease patient model, further followed by clinical trial in patient care. So we did some studies on epithelial cells of the dry eye patients. We took them with the iPrim kit, and then we studied the activity of autophagy in these cells. We found that this dry eye patients had increased hyperoxic conditions in their eyes compared to the normal patients. So this is a small animation which depicts what autophagy is. If there is any inflammatory condition on the ocular surface disorder, it gives rise to the inflammatory components and it damages the epithelial cells on the surface. Whereas intracellularly, the autophagosome which I showed earlier, it takes the degraded cells and merges with the autolysosome to make it die. But if the activity is abnormal or reduced, then the surface epithelial cells are damaged, and which leads to symptoms of ocular surface disorder. So we looked into the literature and we found that Trehalose, rapamycin and baflomycin are the drugs which helps us in modifying the autophagy activity. But when we saw the side effects of the drugs and everything, we found that rapamycin and baflomycin had way more side effects than Trehalose. So we went ahead and did some in vivo studies on Trehalose. We created a desiccation stress model. When we created a desiccation stress model, the cells lost their contour and the shape, but when they were treated with Trehalose, there was restoration of morphology of this desiccation stress after the treatment. Also, the lysosomal activity was raised in desiccation stress model, but when they were treated with Trehalose drops or injectable drops, the lysozyme activity was normal, and also the pH reduced after treating the desiccation stress model with Trehalose. So this is what happens when we use a Trehalose drop. Previously I showed that the autophagy activity was reduced, but here after using them in vivo, the autophagosome activity was increased and it changed the epithelial cell functions and reduced the ocular surface signs and symptoms. So what Trehalose basically does, it maintains the corneal cell viability and functions, acts by protecting proteins and cell membranes from denaturation. It induces autophagy and thereby removes misfolded or aggregated proteins and non-functional cell organelles. It also protects epithelial cells from death by desiccation, relieves ocular discomfort, which is one of the most important factors we would like to give it to our patients, and it promotes a healthy ocular surface environment. So basically what Trehalose does is it regulates the autophagy, it induces it, and also there is more degradation of the dead cells, and autophagy reduces inflammation, thereby it improves the autophagy activity, and probably a drug which may reduce inflammation and boost up autophagy in order to maintain basal conditions in the cell would lead to a happy patient. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pooja, for giving a nice insight into the laboratory background and the research which goes into developing a new molecule. We will wait till the end for questions, but please join us on the dais. And I'd also like to request Dr. Shruti Kochar to come on stage, who's also one of the speakers in this session. The next talk is supposed to be by Dr. Rohit Shetty. He is held up in another session. So what I'll do is I'll give my talk on nutrition and dry eye, and then we will follow that with cases and discussion to make this topic less dry. And then we will have Dr. Rohit Shetty join later on. Thank you. So this is one area which is, sort of shows you the concept of the dark side of the moon, because it is something which is there in front of us, but it is hidden from view. And it is also very difficult to know the truth and to study. So talking about DEWS2, there are several publications which have come up with DEWS2. I'd like to focus your attention on objective 2 of the whole exercise. It was to assess the etiology, mechanism, distribution and impact. And if one understands this better, it automatically takes us to objective three, where if we understand the underlying mechanism better, then we can address the management and therapy appropriately. The great service that these people have done to us is that they've actually made all these publications available, open access, very easily they are available online. So that's, I think, really a remarkable and very generous move. So you do not have to be subscribing to any of the journals. And I would really encourage everybody who's so committed to be here for this session to please read the reports. Now, the epidemiology report is one which has actually highlighted the role of nutrition. And I'm just showing this picture again to show that this has given you the full range of tests and all that you have to do, the whole procedure that you have to follow. But nutrition is still left out. It is still on the dark side of the moon. So obviously, when we are seeing the patients, we do not have time to go into their diet. But I just want to open your mind to the concept that how much of what we do and how much what we take for granted, what we eat every day, it actually has an impact on the conditions that we suffer from. So if you look at this sort of nomogram that you will divide the patient into asymptomatic and symptomatic, and you go along the nomogram and you see, depending upon where the patient comes and then what are the signs present, whether they're with the symptoms or not, and then whether there are neurological symptoms, the pain, the nociceptive symptoms, and then the symptomatic group, you would go into that. But throughout, we have to maybe consider taking a few moments as to looking into the nutrition, because you have varied patients. They all have dry eyes. Some people are manifesting one aspect more, some people the other. And as has already been shown before, it's a very complex disease. It's involving multiple systemic factors, multiple drugs. And nutrition is one more element, the diet. And remember that all this is not mutually exclusive. The human body is not compartmentalized. So everything is acting together. And so this is something that one could consider in certain situations where we find that things are not fitting in and the patient is not responding. And we cannot deny the fact that there is modernization, and modernization is affecting all our lives in some way or the other, whether we're in the urban setup or in rural areas. And so obviously there's an associated stress which is connected with this. And then this might have to lead to certain innovations in the way that we are thinking. We cannot go back. So there is a balance between tradition and progress. And with progress, we cannot say that, oh, it's bad and we have to stop it. Modernization is a part of life. But we can look into certain traditional practices that we had and see if some of those habits can be re-inculcated within our modern lifestyle. Now, if you look at the general components of the diet, we know that the vitamins are important. And we all know generally that for dry eye, it's said to be good to have fish oil, flaxseed oil, minerals, and water. And then you increase complex carbohydrates and the various other components in the diet. So this is a whole list of things that have been explained. But practically, what does it mean? So vitamin A is one of the important elements, and we do know what are the various food sources which are rich in vitamin A. And it's important because a lot of patients will not know. It's not traditionally taught that these are the things which are important in the diet. Often the parents of the child may not even know what's the importance. And if you focus on them, particularly children who are suffering from allergic eye disease, they're being treated for their allergic eye disease, but they do get a corresponding redness. And if you tell the mother that, you know, try to improve the diet of the child, maybe that will add an extra element in helping the person get back to health. The other vitamin is vitamin B. B6 and B12 have been supposed to be maybe more contributing to the ocular neuropathic pain. So maybe you have given all the treatment which normally your patients respond to. One particular patient is coming and saying, complaining of, sometimes they complain of a very peculiar pain and you cannot find any cause for it. So those particular patients may actually be deficient in vitamin B. And if you're really worried about it, you can even get the blood test done. And vitamin B is also present in a whole host of things that we normally eat. A variety of foods, particularly garlic, it's there, and it's also there in various colored fruits and nuts. Vitamin C is a powerful antioxidant. As the previous speakers have mentioned, stress, pollution, environmental problems, all of these are increasing the level of oxidants in our body. So antioxidant neutralizing effect could be there with vitamin vitamin C, which can also be, again, particularly you have students who are living in hostels or away from home, they're studying, they're stressed, and they don't even have time to look after their diet. So even the parents can suggest that you at least have a banana. They don't have to worry about washing it, cutting it, and all that. So, you know, you can try to encourage them to include fruit and vegetables in their diet as simply as possible they can in their daily life. Vitamin E is another vitamin which is supposed to be contributory to better eye health in terms of the tear film stability and components. And almonds, spinach, sweet potato. Now, almonds might be expensive, but sweet potato is relatively cheap and easily available. Similarly, sunflower seeds, palm oil, these are the various foods that patients can include into their diet. And antioxidants, as I mentioned, vitamin C, plus we have the other healthful foods. And as I explained, there is a natural process of aging where the oxidant levels increase in our body, aging, poor diet, lack of exercise, and unhealthy lifestyle. So while you explain to the patient to try to neutralize these influences in their daily life, they can also try to have something in their nutrition to neutralize the effect of this. So as we have smokers, we have people on alcohol, medications, and chronic stress. So when you had that chart which I showed you, these elements are not coming so much in that. So if you have a person who is not responding to treatment, maybe you can take a few extra minutes, go back and see if they have any of these elements, and then you can also encourage them to look at the diet. Now, traditional Indian meals are actually very balanced. They're very fulfilling. And if you just look back, it was not common long ago to have your grandparents putting eye drops all the time. It may be because of the different environmental conditions which are changing that it is becoming more frequent. It's not only a question of more awareness, but where in anybody's life can you actually consider having such meals morning and evening? It's very difficult to even have a basic meal often in many families. So therefore, one could maybe space it out. One need not have such an elaborate meal, but try to have one or two dishes and then supplemented with fruit and vegetables, and then spaced out throughout the day as practically possible as can be managed. So whole grains and fish can be encouraged. If you're going to have fish, then one can concentrate on having the fish which are rich in omega-3 fatty acid, sardines and salmon, essential fatty acid nutrients, cold water fish, oil, salmon, halibut, and flax seeds are very easy. They're not inexpensive. In Hindi, they're known as alsi beej. I'm sure in all other languages, there's some word for them. They can be put a teaspoon in the diet, in the dalia, or whatever the person is having for breakfast, or even in the yogurt. Green tea, another very useful antioxidant, rich source, strong organic variety, which can be used. Potassium is also very low in patients with dry eye. This can be supplemented again with bananas, dates, figs, raisins. Raisins are relatively less expensive, and bananas. And then zinc is another important component. It is important for various enzyme activities. It's present in dark chocolate, kidney beans, rajma, mushrooms, garlic, egg yolks. And don't forget water. So we need about 20% of the water requirement should come from the food we eat, but the rest has to come as liquid. So we should have healthy, clean drinking water and try to drink at least 6 to 8 glasses a day. Another thing that you find that you have to actually stress to students because they do not remember to drink water. So I'll end here. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am, for really inventing talk regarding. We can, as Rohit Shetty not here now at present, we can go to the case discussion. Is this a dry eye? Dr. Sharon D'Souza.
Good morning, everyone. So very quickly, I think all of us see dry eye in our clinics, and you will agree that it comes in a variety of presentations and a variety of patients with a lot of symptomatology, a lot of signs, or sometimes none at all. And it is up to us to decide whether they actually have a problem or and what should we treat and how. So the spectrums could be anything. The patient could have no symptoms at all or symptoms so severe that they cannot open the eyes. And they may already be on multiple drops or treatment. They could have already been extensively examined and evaluated. Or some of them just think they have dry eye, unfortunately highlighted by our dear friend Google. So this is a wide variety of the, you know, the kind of patients who can come in with dry eye. And there are a lot of masquerades to dry eye as well, and dry eye itself can masquerade a number of conditions. So it is up to us to figure out which of these could be dry eye. And even this patient, who actually is a post-LASIK patient, will have no signs, but the patient could be extremely symptomatic because of a break in the reflex arc. So I'm just going to discuss a few cases which highlight what, you know, a little unusual cases of dry eye. So if a patient comes like this, then we are happy because straight out we know there's a lot of punctate erosions. You lift the lid, you're seeing filaments there, you do your Schirmer's test and you've got a low Schirmer's and you know how to treat it, and there's a stepwise system of how you go about, and the patient should do fairly well. But what happens if the spectrum or the picture, the clinical picture, changes a little bit? So I had this patient who came in, 40-year-old lady. She was wheelchair-bound. She's a known case of rheumatoid arthritis. Unfortunately, due to financial restrictions, she had stopped all her medications. And this is how her cornea looked. And this is a classic contact lens cornea that you see in these patients with rheumatoid. And if you see, this entire cornea has thinned out in the periphery. And only the central part is actually the normal cornea. So if we just give lubricants in such a patient, obviously we'd be highly under-treating this patient. And they need a detailed evaluation. They need the immunologist in conjunction. They need a lot of systemic medications to try and salvage what is left of the eye. So as Dr. Radhika and Dr. Arup were saying, it is very important to go to the root of the problem. We need to understand it's not just putting the lubricant drops. There's a lot of cohesive treatment which is required. Another patient who came with an area of a sterile corneal melt. And an easy thing would be to jump to a conclusion of dry eye, but in this case, unfortunately, the dry eye evaluation was equivocal. The tests were borderline, which very often happens with these tests. Immune workup was done. That also came normal. ESR was a little high. So this patient didn't actually have a dry eye, but especially because of the location of the thinning and the melt. But another patient who has this classic central perforation, which we see in the palpable region, is most likely a dry eye, and you need to go back, check your dry eye evaluation very carefully, especially initially there'll be a lot of inflammation there. So check the other eye, and the management should be as appropriate. I had only 5 minutes, so I'm going to just close up with this case. And this is similar to what Dr. Radhika was saying. As this is a patient who came in, she's from a rural background. On examination, she was extremely malnourished, and she had decreased vision and photophobia since 6 months. She was referred for a penetrating keratoplasty, and this was how her eye looked. And if you just see this area, it's a severely vascularized eye, a lot of superficial vascularization. And this area has what looks like a keratin plaque. It's actually area of xerosis. And even in the other eye, there's a lot of vascularization and the eye is inflamed. This patient had borderline Schirmer's tests, low Schirmer's, and we started on oral vitamin A. And this is how the eye looks after 3 weeks when this entire area of xerosis has completely disappeared. Obviously, she will need long-term therapy, and you know, we have to go back and look what else is going wrong in that eye. But definitely something as simplistic as that does have a role to play, as long as we can go back and find the root cause and add that to the treatment of dry eye along with our lubricant drops. Just to see, very often it can masquerade, you know, there can be other conditions which can masquerade, and this is nowhere near a dry eye, it's actually an ocular secretorial pemphigoid. So always beware, you know, an eye which is inflamed, the patient is photophobic, not opening the eyes, look at the lids, it's very important, evert, look at the fornices, so that we don't miss something which is much more malignant. So always differentiate between dry eye and its mimickers. Compare the symptoms and signs because they can be hugely disparate. And remember that aqueous deficient and evaporative dry eye are not mutually exclusive. So we may have to have a multi-pronged approach. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Thank you. That was a very nice explanatory overview with some nice case examples. And we now have Dr. Shruti Kochar, and she's going to tell us predicting dry eye post-surgery.
A very warm good afternoon. I'll be speaking on predicting dry eye post-surgery. I have no financial interest. Modern-day cataract surgery have an excellent rate of patient satisfaction. However, we still encounter patients who are not happy at all, despite having a perfect surgery. So I'll be sharing some cases. This is a survey conducted at Narayan Netralaya. We evaluated 115 patients in the interval of 6 months. We used a quality of vision questionnaire. And the patients who were unhappy, we tried to dig into the reason. So the most common cause of unhappy patient was dry eyes, close to 50%. Dry eye can be induced by surgery in many ways: meibomian gland dysfunction, transient spasm of lacrimal gland due to peribulbar block, corneal incisions can damage the nerve, the preservatives in the eye drop can cause increased osmolarity and decreased pH of the tear film. Coming to the cases, this 25-year-old female underwent LASIK 8 months back. She complained of blurring of vision. She was terribly unhappy. Her unaided vision was 6/6 parts. She did not improve with glasses. Anterior-posterior segments were both normal. Mibography normal, Schirmer's normal, but her tear film breakup time was as low as 4 seconds. After performing all the routine investigations and topography, which definitely came out normal, we did OCAS for this patient. OCAS is an HD analyzer based on double pass system. It enables real-time analysis of the optical quality of the tear film. The figure on the top are the simulated E-chart retinal image and scatter of a normal patient, whereas the one at the bottom is of this patient with abnormal tear film. Her optical scatter index was very high. It was 1.9. After treating this patient with appropriate lubricant, her symptoms disappeared and she was happy again. This is another case of a 58-year-old gentleman who underwent premium IOL 1 year back, terribly unhappy. He complained of fluctuation of vision. His vision was 6/6, but still he had a fluctuating vision with burning sensation in the eye. Anterior-posterior segments both were normal. On examination, the IOL was well-centered, Schirmer's normal, but on careful examination, patient had meibomian gland dysfunction. We did lippy view for this patient. Lippy view projects a white light onto the cornea, which gives an interference pattern. The one on the left is of a normal cornea with a good specular reflection. The one on the right is of this patient with a poor lipid layer. The ICU value is 49. ICU is interferometric color unit. Any value less than 60 is considered abnormal. We usually get the patients to fill OSDI scoring, and it was very high in this patient. So apart from meibography, we also did confocal microscopy, which shows increased dendritic cells along with some angry nerves, which is suggestive of subclinical inflammation. So these are the lippy view clipping. After the treatment of MGD, the lipid layer improved, as you can see on the right, and the quality of vision improved, and the patient was happy again. So dry eye can be that difference between a 6/6 happy and a 6/6 unhappy patient. So take that extra 1 minute to evaluate for dry eye and treat the MGD appropriately with lubricants, immunomodulator, and doxycycline. It can definitely result in better outcome. So the methods to assess lipid layer and optical quality definitely is a good clinical examination. We can also assess lipid, apart from TBUT, we can assess it using LipiView. The ASOCT gives good epithelial mapping. Then meibography can be done using a keratograph. And the tear film can be analyzed for the optical quality using OCAS and a confocal for the dendritic cells and nerve morphology. And do not forget OSDI scoring. It's a wonderful, simple sheet which can give a lot of clue. So try to evaluate preoperatively. Look for medications like retinoids, antihistaminics. Do not forget to customize lubricant for each patient, and especially contact lens users, they might need more lubricant post-operatively. MGD treatment is of utmost importance. Do good orthoptic evaluation for a computer user, nutritional supplement as Madam has already described, and maybe behavioral and workspace modification will definitely give a better outcome after any refractive or cataract surgery. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Shruti. So you mentioned some new investigations, and I'm sure people would like to ask you questions, but maybe we can take it after the next talk, and then we can have the question and answer interaction. So Dr. Karishma Wadia is going to tell us about MMP9 kits. Are they good?
Thank you, Dr. Radhika. Since dry eye is on the rise, we have been seeing an increase in the number of dry eye clinics in across a lot of cities. Now, apart from your normal Schirmer's and T-Bud, which we can routinely perform in any ophthalmological setup, you are also looking at investigative modalities like imaging of the meibomian glands, which had started on a large scale so that you can show your patient what exactly is wrong with them. And then came up this MMP9 kit Inflamma dry eye, which was an addition to your kitty of dry eye workup. Now, we all know that dry eye has a multifactorial etiopathogenesis, and mainly inflammation plays a pivotal role. And how does it play a pivotal role? Because it increases the pro-inflammatory markers, namely matrix metalloproteinase, which causes epithelial cell apoptosis, lymphocytic infiltration, and lacrimal function paralysis, which are the main reasons why the patient has a lot of subjective discomfort. So there are lots of studies which show that MMP9 is increased in inflammation, not just in dry eye, also in allergic eye disease, also in other conditions like conjunctivocalasis. And because of the influence of MMP9 on various ocular structures, it causes a subjective discomfort in terms of irritation, burning, pricking, and pain. So let's look at this Inflamma dry eye RPS kit. Now, RPS stands for rapid pathogen screening. So like the name suggests, it's a rapid screening test. And the biggest advantage is that it's so simple and quick. It takes around 10 to 15 minutes in your OPD. It's disposable, it's low cost. It's a useful tool to explain to your patient during a busy OPD why you want to do the test, because you want to decide what your management would be like. And the you just have to put it onto the lower conjunctiva of the patient and add it to the buffer medium, and it will give you your result positive or negative. On the basis of that, you can treat. How can you treat? There's a study by Dr. Samborski. He describes the entire management of dry eye based on the result of Inflamma dry eye. So if you have an Inflamma dry eye positive, then you would go ahead with anti-inflammatory drugs because your MMP9 values are more than 40 nanograms per ml. And if it's negative, then you can safely go ahead with just a pure simple lubricant. Now, to know whether this test is actually useful for us or not, we would need to compare it with a standardized protocol, which is namely an ELISA test. So where your RPS kit is going to give you a qualitative analysis, it is going to measure total MMP9, active as well as latent, and give you just a cutoff value, 40. If it's above 40, it's positive. If it's below 40, it's negative. ELISA is going to give you your exact value of MMP9 in that particular tear film. So to know whether they are good, we're going to compare Inflamma dry eye versus an ELISA-based laboratory test. I would like to thank Dr. Rohit for sharing this data of his hospital with us. This is a study done in Narayan Netralaya, and where he's compared every patient, he's analyzed their tears, not just on the Inflamma dry eye, he's also compared it with an ELISA test in the same patient. So the RPS test is performed as per routine, sample is collected, the test is assembled, kept in the buffer, and the results are read as positive or negative. The ELISA test, how do you perform it? You allow the Schirmer strip to entirely be soaked by the patient's tears, and then it is stored in an Eppendorf tube at minus 80 degrees Celsius. It is chopped into multiple pieces, and then an ELISA test is performed on it. Now, amongst the results of the NN group, we saw that the RPS test positive eyes had higher MMP9 values as compared to the negative, which is obvious, and the ELISA test had a great dynamic range of detection. But the ELISA test for more than 40 nanograms per ml showed a high even in RPD negative patients. So we studied this in further detail. So basically what we saw was that in the patients who were negative on the screening test, if your Inflamma dry eye showed you that it's negative, these patients on ELISA showed very high values, much beyond 40. What is the importance of this? The importance is that we're missing out on those three patients who have a large amount of inflammation. So if you go by Dr. Samborski's study, you will not give him anti-inflammatory treatment. But is that really what you want to do? Probably not, because you're going to miss out on treating this really subjectively uncomfortable patient. So false negative test results can delay the appropriate treatment. So what the previous studies quoted were that these rapid pathogen screening tests were relatively good in terms of sensitivity as well as specificity. But the subjects who were positive for this test are not necessarily high even in the ELISA test group. That's possibly because of the time delay in transferring it from the cold storage in the cold chain to the lab. So basically what we saw, that if you compare the standardized ELISA and RPD kids, the three patients who we lost out on, who showed as negative on the kit and who are actually very high on the ELISA, is what we are worried about. We should not base our management just on this kit. So if you have this kit in your OPD, you can use it, yes, but don't let your entire management be based on it. Don't miss out on a good clinical examination, as well as looking for clinical signs of the patient's eyes and his subjective discomfort, and treat according to that. Don't let just the kit decide whether you should treat or not treat with the appropriate drugs. Thank you very much. So we already know that RPD test is used, but what this study adds is just that it does not agree very well with the ELISA values. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Karishma. So in a way, that translates to the report that we often get from the radiologists, as to say, please correlate clinically.
Absolutely.
So that goes without saying. But I would say that it sounds like a good tool for those who like to have some basis when they're starting some treatment. So you have very obvious inflammation. Maybe in those patients, you will not do the test routinely. But there are some of the cases where there's no obvious inflammation, there's not responding to treatment. So you may be worried that whether there is any hidden inflammation. So those would be the cases which would benefit from the investigation. So Dr. Rohit Shetty has just joined us. So while he's getting his slides ready for presentation, maybe we could take two questions if there are any. And I request you to please take the mic and ask the question.
Dr. Karishma, you said low cost. Can I know what is the cost of the RPT kit?
So the cost to the patient, which comes on the MRP label, is 1800 for a kit. So that would be 1800 per eye, effectively.
So that is 3600.
Yes, yes.
It's
which
not
is why
low cost.
Yes, I wouldn't say it's absolutely low cost, but when you are having a dry eye clinic and you're doing an array of tests like nevography and keratograph and all of that, I'm sure the patient can afford the inflammatory as well. So okay. It's obviously going to be for that category of patients where you're looking at that. And like Dr. Radhika said, if there's obvious inflammation, you don't want to waste your time. I typically would think it would be of use in patients where they've already been using lubricants since forever, and then they come to you, especially for a cornea opinion particularly, and they ask you why you're now adding three more drops to the list of already two drops and one ointment that they have. So it wouldn't be easy to then explain it to them.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So it's a pleasure to have Dr. Rohit Shetty join for this session, and he's going to explain unknown pathways for unusual symptoms.
Thank you, ma'am. I had my own IC there, so I just couldn't leave it. So thank you. Thanks, Microvision and AIOS, for this session. These are all my financial interests. Received grants from all of them, but I'm sure it's not going to come in the way of what I'm going to speak today. I'm sure you've seen this slide many times today. But what is interesting is the small thing what I picked up. These are all new things which has been added from the DUCE 1, DUCE 2, about the neuropathic pain. Finally, we as ophthalmologists and the group has accepted that something called as a neuropathic pain, otherwise it was more the domain of neurologists. So what really is the pathways? The study is what I'm going to speak today. So we made this kind of an animated picture. When you, it's not just from the eye, from anywhere where there is pain, whether it's muscular pain, neuropathic pain, spinal pain, there are a bunch of pro-inflammatory factors which are looking at the nociceptive, because these are nociceptive receptors which makes you hypersensitive to everything. And this is what triggers off all your symptoms, even allodyna, even, you know, something sometimes which looks like a psychiatric symptoms, even in the eye, it because it works on the goblet cells level. So we've been working on this. I call it the pain without stain study, because you are, let's assume for this presentation that all your other staining and your shermas and everything is normal. So you don't need to worry about them. So most important thing when you look at any of these patients is to listen to their symptoms, listen to their problems very carefully, because sometimes these problems borderline a psychiatric problem, because they come to you with problems saying that I speak loudly, my eye hurts. When somebody's speaking loudly, when it hurts, and you wonder what is all this, because you know, I can understand something going into the eyes, but not something, a music, a strong music, smell. Somebody has a perfume, my eye starts watering. That means that it all comes under the same category of the neuropathic factors, and that's came under the whole thing of neuropathic pain. For example, this is LASIK patients who underwent LASIK in Europe, recurrent erosions, how a normal nerve would regenerate. But in this case, if you go deeper, nerves never regenerated, dendritic cells all over, and the keratocytes are normal post-surgery after 9 months. In his case, the keratocytes are still angry, activated, and doing something which we don't know. So why I put this case is, we get a lot of these patients where this is normal, but thankfully, if you have a confocal, you can pick it up, but that doesn't review the full picture. So what next? The most important test in your practice is, according to me, to pick up this pain or neuropathic patients is the OSDI questionnaire. And you have a discomfort scale, which we have divided, and you have, which tells you how bad his discomfort is. And then you have a vision scale, which we looked at this. I'm not going deep into how we analyze that, but from the tears, you can pick up, just like you pick up from the spinal or your fluid or any fluid, you can pick up all these neuropathic factors. So if you look at this balance, a normal balance like all of us do have all these factors with us. We have it with us, but we don't have those problems because there is a huge balance. If one thing is high, the other one is high, the other one is low. But when the tilt of the balance falls to this side, that's when you start having all your problems. This is the traditional way of how you get any kind of this unknown symptoms. So what happens is your nutritional factors, your autophagy, which I assume has been spoken, all these things can change your factors, which triggers off that feeling of uneasiness, the feeling of pain, the feeling of something which a patient himself or hers cannot explain. For that, you need to understand these things. This is the most important thing when you're trying to decode unknown symptoms. So if you look at this exaggerated response, these are all nociceptive pain mediator fibers, and you have those receptors on the nerves. These are the blue ones are the blockers. They're pro-nociceptive. They block it. So, but when you have an activation of pain, they go and hit on these receptors, and you have this excessive firing of neurons. And when you have those neurons, you get all kinds of problems. For example, look at this. This is, again, these are all, we call it as a cold thermoreceptors. These are, again, they are sensitive to this air, sink, talk, perfumes, music, because those are all vibrations. And again, they can have this triggers of response. This is what happens in these patients, and sometimes we don't even believe them, because this is a molecular pathway of what really happens in your cornea. So reason I mentioned this is because our old way of understanding and old methods of treatments or examination really will not help here. So one of the things when I started working on vitamin D was people used to say that you treat everything with the vitamin D because 80% or 70 to 80% of Indians are deficient. It's true. But any disease for you to get, you have to have, we need to understand that they need to be there as a receptor level here, because each of these receptors, what it means is, it is secreting without the need of sunlight. This is the human epithelial cells, and God does not put anything in the body which is not useful to us. That means it has to be useful in some way. This is, imagine you take this vitamin D and put any disease, leukemia, cancers, tumors, the model is the same. The model is you have to first have a disease factors which can cause a disease for you. You have to have a genetic background and you have to have a host response, how you respond. If you have one of the two, you're just subclinical. That means you may never get the disease in your life. You may have, that means you may, you are a smoker here, you have a response of some changes in your lung, but your genes are strong, you never get a lung cancer. You may have a genetic response, but you don't smoke, but you're a passive smoker, but you're not a smoker actively, you don't get a response. But if you have, you are a smoker, you have a genes, and you also have a changes in your lung, you get lung cancer. Exactly the same thing happens in vitamin D or any nutrition thing. You have a disease because you are low on vitamins. Your response of deficiency is manifested a billion times more than normal, and you have a hidden genetic background which makes you to be susceptible. And that is why, even though we have 70% deficient in our country, only 10% of them are suffering, because they have all the three things. I borrowed this slide from a cancer model. Whether it's cancer or anything, the pathway is the same. And then you have a bunch of other things which happens at the cellular component. So we started looking from just a clinical observation 4-5 years back. Then we started seeing what happens when we treat, and then moved on. And for future, I mean, I'm just giving an example of one. Vitamin D is not the only factor, but that is the only modifiable factor what we can test in. And you can also look at how each of your dendritic cells is connected to how your nutrition can actually change your dendritic cells, which are the most important thing for the state of health of the eye. And this is when we compare the vitamin D versus thing. I'm just giving an example of how unknown pathways can be checked. And also, when we look at the previous slide, many of these factors get modified once you start them on a treatment. But you treat systemically, but locally we don't treat. So that's where inflammatory, anti-inflammatories Trelupes or all these chloroquines or Restasis or all these drugs play a very important role in trying to block them, because anti-inflammatory is also an important factor. Dry eye today is like six blind men and an elephant. Each one of us looking at one arm of it and trying to make a whole story, because the story is still far away from complete. But each of us start looking at it one, and suddenly then open our eyes, and then probably we can completely the whole thing. Because most of the time, the dry eye management, even though it's a simple thing, doesn't follow a normal distribution. It's quite paranormal out here. So there's a lot to explore, and I'm ready for questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rohit. You can please join on the dais, and we'll take questions. Before we do that, the faculty involved in this session have actually contributed towards putting together a booklet, and with your permission, we'll just take 2 minutes to release the booklet, and then that would be distributed to you afterwards. I'd like to acknowledge Microvision for having published the booklet. So would you like to release? So fortunately, we do have 10 minutes for questions. So if anybody would like to ask questions to any of the speakers. Could you use the mic, please?
One case, you said that vitamin A corrected so much of dryness of the eye. What's the way of approach, systemic or local? First question. Second, in the commercial, we have so many drops are available. Methyl cellulose, carboxymethyl cellulose, povidone, the substance. Can you, with the code, can you highlight in which are conditions we can use hypermellose or methyl cellulose like that? Can you elaborate?
Yeah, so I'll just speak about the case which had a severe vitamin A deficiency. What we did was give oral vitamin A, actually. That patient was highly malnourished, so required oral vitamin A. What we have available is Aquasol. But there must be many medications which are available, trade names. So I had given it for 2 weeks of oral. But
Yes, now talking about the lubricants that you would start with. So fortunately, this DEWS 2 and even DEWS 1 had given a very nice algorithm. So if you're talking about a mild dry eye where you have to just replenish the tears, just improve the aqueous component of the tears, then you can choose HPMC, CMC. These are the products that you can use. If supposing then each molecule has a few more qualities, like for example CMC, that carboxymethyl cellulose, it has an epithelial protective effect. It also helps a little bit in the healing of epithelial defects. So therefore, if you have a person with punctate erosions, any epithelial defect, then you could use a CMC containing product. Sodium hyaluronate has the benefit of absorbing and being lasting for a longer time, plus a higher molecular weight sodium hyaluronate has the ability to withstand shear forces. So therefore, if you require the drug to act for a longer time and you would give greater comfort by using a product which contains sodium hyaluronate, and you may like to sometimes combine CMC with sodium hyaluronate. Now when you go to the moderate to severe dry eye, where all of us believe that there is the inflammation which could either be the cause or the effect, but definitely there is an amount of inflammation. So rather than using steroid drops in such cases, one would use these newer molecules that you have which have an anti-inflammatory effect. So either they are the smart molecules that were described like cyclosporin and tacrolimus, or you can use trehalose, which is also giving you, they are the molecules which have multiple effects. And if there's more inflammation than that, you can use a short term of topical steroids to help in controlling the inflammation more aggressively, more effectively. And then after a week, you can go off. And there, when we use topical steroids, you use surface acting steroids like fluoromethylone or lotiprednol, because you do not really require them to enter into the aqueous and produce intraocular rays, intraocular pressure, and so on. So the DEWS 2 is very nicely given you a rough algorithm, and I would ask Dr. Rohit or Dr. Bhaumik if they would like to add anything further.
But I want to ask you a question. How relevant is DEWS 2 for Indian scenario? I mean, each one of you can answer this, because when you look at the DEWS 2, it is made for a different population. I know there are Indian co-authors in that, but don't you really think that we need a DEWS 2 kind of a thing for India?
So that is an important concept, that the population in which it has been studied has a different lifestyle, different diet, and maybe it may not be directly translatable into the Indian population, but more or less giving the concept that human body is sort of universal. So we will have to validate it, and I think it's a good suggestion that we could have it validated with a multi-center kind of an approach and see how relevant it is. But as of today, I think that it is a very good document, and we can all try to follow it, and then we can have a kind of a feedback to one central place. Maybe we can even have that people can give their feedback, maybe through AIOS, or we can have any of these societies who may want to have a forum where people can, rather than having a large study which will be very expensive to do, we can encourage ophthalmologists that you can look at these aspects, and if you find any weaknesses, then you can give the feedback. And mentioning about the molecules, there's also ribamapide, which has a secretagogue effect and mucomimetic mucin secreting effect, and there is also chloroquine drops. So there are a lot of drops available, but you can put them into categories and follow a kind of a rational approach when treating the patients.
This is a question regarding vitamin D supplementation in dry eye. So in what, how to choose which patient require that supplement, and what should be the algorithm of vitamin D supplementation in dry eye patients?
Yes, so would you like to take that question?
See, it depends on how severe your symptoms are. Your severe symptoms are very severe and you have no signs, what I mentioned. See, I manage them, we can also do it, but I manage with the physician. one of the things you need to understand, low vitamin D does not mean that you should have a disease. The cornea epithelial cells have receptors for vitamin D called the VDR receptor, vitamin D receptors. The vitamin D receptors get shut down when there is inflammation. It could be the other way loop mechanism also. So if you, what, this is not published work, but what in our work, what we're realizing now is, anything which is a slow increase of vitamin D does not make the vitamin D receptor to open up. So you may have a lots of vitamin D, but the receptors are shut down. To have a receptors open up, you need a bolus dose. It's like an optic neuritis. You need a bolus dose for them to open, not the oral thing. So vitamin D, a VDR receptor is more important as an etiopathogenesis than low vitamin D. People may have a lot of vitamin D, but they may not have the receptor functioning because the inflammation can shut it down. So traditionally what a physician would do is, if it's in a single digit, say less than 10, if it's a thing, then he treats them with the injectables. And if the symptoms are very high, so the injectables could be around 6 lakhs international units over one dose intramuscular, then wait for a month, then maybe 3 doses he may require. But if his symptoms are very high and still his vitamin D is also on a higher side, still I go in for an injectable because I want that receptors to kick function. It's like, but when it's on a higher side and the symptoms are moderate, then the oral supplement should work. This is what I follow as my algorithm.
In oral supplement, would you prefer tablet or nowadays
as a sachet
come with the spray also?
Yeah, the spray, so one spray is only 1000 international units, and 1000 international units sublingually, that means I don't know how much it reaches to that level. It's just every spray you do is only 1000.
Is there a cordless mic for Dr. Panda?
Yeah, Dr. Shetty, thank you very much for all these things. One thing you have to remember, that whenever you are giving the vitamin D, you have to supplement with calcium. Unless until you supplement with that, neither you get systemic effect or local effect. And two or three things Dr. Radhika has explained very nicely. I think you have to explain them about the duration. That is very important. And sometimes, no, same group of drug, but the brand is changed. So you have to speak about that. These two are very, very important. You have to take them. And vitamin D and calcium should be given simultaneously. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes. There is one more question. After that, we'll have to hand over, but we can have one more question.
You see, the prevalence of basically the dry eye is increasing. You do get a lot of systemic conditions like AIDS, after LASIK, after rheumatoid arthritis, after corneal dystrophy. In all these conditions, we have an association of the AIDS. Like routinely you do this LASIK, you have a dry eye. Rheumatoid arthritis, manifestation is dry eye. AIDS, manifestation, one of these, dry eye. So in all these systemic conditions, basically, we have to supplement them with carboxymethyl cellulose.
Quite right. So a knowledge of the unknown risk factors and the underlying systemic diseases, if the person is known to have them, then you would start them on suitable medications depending upon how symptomatic they are. And there is a nice algorithm in the DUES too, which I think we can follow and generally collect our own data and see how relevant it is to the Indian context. So with that, I'd like to thank all the speakers and the audience for making the session very useful and interactive. Thank you, everyone. And I'd like to also acknowledge Microvision for their help in putting together this booklet and making it available for all of you. Thank you.